stop me anytime and you can ask me anytime. I believe it is a good task that we are taking over, and let's get into the session. Right. So in the previous session, what we completed it with is to understand what are all the types of instruction. Am I right? We just understood what are the three types of instructions that are available. One is R type, the second one is I type, and the third one is J type. I'll go slow today, and since a couple of you told that it's a bit faster, I'm slowing it down a bit today. If you want it further slower, probably you'll have to think about it. Then you need to listen carefully, right? So the first instruction that we need to look into is R-type. I repeat it now because it is very important. So please listen. This is the R-type instruction that we are talking about, and the add, sub, all these kind of instructions, arithmetics will come in into this picture. And when you talk about R-type instruction, the major components of this instruction would be registers. You can see that here, add R1, I'll zoom it a bit. Add R1, R2, I mean S1, S2, S2 or some registers are there. So don't worry about the numbers right now. And these are the registers that are playing the major role in the entire process. So the point is simple out here. When we see the registers as the components out in the instruction, we can call it R-type. And the R-type instruction and every other instruction for that matter is 32 bits wide, and 0 to 31 is the length. And in that, it starts with the function code, then shift amount, RD, RT, RS. You cannot change it. Remember, it is always RD, RT, and RS. You cannot and you must not change it. Remember it. This is a very important point. Many of you make a mistake there in the exam. So please do not do that. It is RD, destination register, and these two are source registers. Now, all the registers are 5 bits wide because 2 to the power of 5 is only 32. So I've got 5, 5, 5 here. So it is totally 15 occupied here, and shift amount is 15. You can see that rest are only 12 bits available. So opcode is always 6 bits, and this is 6 bits. That's it. So I hope you understood what is R-type instruction and how is it structured. When you write it, you need to write it as add, I mean the instruction, followed by RD, destination comes first, first source and the second source. That's all. Sir, what is the opcode, sir? What is function code? Don't worry, I'll tell you what it is. Opcode is the one that will tell you what type of operation is it. Is it an R-type instruction or a J-type or something like that? Function will tell you what exactly is the function that you are going to do. Is it an addition? Is it a subtraction? Is it a multiplication? Or what is that you are going to do will be determined by this function. So both has got codes, and we will use that codes, and we will have to see that a little later. Not now. Now, this is immediate type instruction, where we need to have the offset available here, which is going to be an immediate part of the instruction. Whenever you have the immediate content available there, like what we have seen in the last semester, it is called immediate instructions. And we have got only two registers out working in play here. One is RS and another one is RT. Remember, RS and RT, any register when you take is only 5 bits wide. Remember, it can be only 5 bits wide. So you have occupied already 10 bits. And offset, as I told you, it's only 16 bits. So 16 plus 6 is 22 and balance is 10 bits. So we have tackled it here and it is managed. Now the final one is nothing but your J-type instruction. Opcode is 6 bit. So the rest all field would be the address field. And that's called the 26 bit field in the J-type instruction. When you say jump to there, the to there is nothing but the address that we are specifying. And that would come into the space. And that is 26 bits. Is it clear till now? These three instructions are very fundamental, and all the instructions that we are going to see will fall under one of these three types, right? So we will get into something which is very, very important. I'll go very slow. If you have any queries, please stop me in between and you are free to stop. Let's interact. Okay. Now, we need to learn the design rules. What is design rules, sir? Whenever you are designing anything, whenever you are designing a processor for that matter, you need to follow certain set of rules. The rules will enable the usage of the processor in a very neat way. The rules will enable the end user to use it in a nice way, and the programmer to use it without any problem or flaw. So there are some design rules which are already curated and for MIPS, which is already ready with us. And we are going to see about that. It will take at least two sessions for us to complete this. I'm going to talk about the first two rules, if at all possible today, otherwise I'll complete it with the first rule alone. If time permits, we'll go to the second one. We are in no hurry. We'll go step by step. Now, the first question that we need to ask, if I talk to you in Latin, if you do not know Latin, can you understand that? No, right? The answer is very obvious. You won't understand. So what is it very important for us? We need to communicate to anybody in the language that they can understand. That's it. That's the first point that you need to remember. Whenever we talk to computer, we need to talk to it in the format that it can understand. So what is the format that it can understand? Instructions. What are instructions? That is nothing but the one that we will pull out for doing some operation like addition, subtraction, etc. All these instructions are grouped together and they are put up in a box called as instruction set architecture or IS instruction set. Now, this instruction set is going to talk to the computer, and this is called the complete secret of computing. Whenever you have very good instruction set which can interact with your processor hardware very nicely, that instruction set takes you to the next level. So remember, everything that we are going to talk to computer is what we are thinking about. We need to make sure we are giving it a very right set of instructions for it to perform right set of tasks, and it should be understood by it. Now, we are going to take a very simple instruction now. Add x, y, z. So what we will do, we will add y and z and we will move the result to x. Can we change it? Can we change the notation? This is called MIPS notation. Add x, y, z. Now, what is this x? This x is called RD. RD is the destination register. What is this y called as? This y is called RT. This z is called as RS. I'm just swapping it. It can be RS and RD or RS and RT. Don't worry. These two are called as the source registers, and this is called as destination register. This is what I told you here. I have got the source register. I have got the RT, RS. When you write it, it will be like add. RD is most important, and these two will be presented as the source registers. That's what exactly is done here. Can we change it? Can we move RT to RD to RS? Can we change the notation? No, you cannot do. Understand one point, MIPS is extremely inflexible. Each operation, when you take that corresponding type of instruction, will have three operands. You cannot add with just two operands. You cannot say that, sir, can I add Y and Z? Automatically, can the result not go to something called as accumulator? No, you cannot do that. You need to specify all the three registers every time when you take that instruction. It is highly inflexible. MST is a batsman. He is not a bowler. He could have bowled once, but forget it. He is predominantly a batsman and he cannot bowl. It's only one action possible for one particular instruction. Each instruction can do only one task. Remember, each instruction can do only one task and not more than that. You will have each instruction married to one particular specific operation, and it will not be expected to do, or it cannot do, any other operation more than that. That's it. So very simple guideline that I have told you. Now only we are getting into the rules and regulations. After maybe 5 minutes, I'll get into it. So whatever I have discussed now is the fundamental stuff. Now, let's understand, we need to write C code. And whatever we are going to do is mostly C code or C++ code. And in C code, we put it very simply, C equal to A plus B plus C. Now, we are going to have a challenge here. Let's have some fun. Q, R, S, T are the registers which are to be added, and the results is to be put into P. Q, R, S, T are the registers which are to be added, and we are expected to place the result in P. Now, when we have to write it in C programming, it's very simple. P equal to Q plus R plus S plus T, we can put it that way, and it's going to be very easy for us. But when you come in into MIPS, that too, we are going to add. So as I told you, we need three operands for sure. So what is the first step? I'll take Q and R. Q and R will be added, and I'm moving the result to P. Now, what is the next step? I have got Q and R done, so I can take S now. The result is available already in the P register. So add P, P, S. This P and S would be added, and the result will now go into P. So we are done with Q, R, S. It's all done. And the result is available in P. Now we are yet to add T. So P, T should be added for us to get in into the final result, which is to be moved to P. Now, it is all appearing like complex because we have got three instructions. But this is what is MIPS all about. MIPS cannot be flexible. I cannot add four operands. I cannot add two operands. I need to go mandatorily with three operands. Though it takes three or four steps, though it takes four or five instructions, it doesn't matter. Each line has got one instruction, and that's it. That one instruction alone will be used there. It has mandatorily three operands, and that's the way we can go ahead. You may have one or two instructions extra when you compare it to other methods or other instructions at architectures, but this is how MIPS works. This is just MIPS things. And remember, whenever you are writing a code in the paper or whenever you are writing it in the interview, I am talking about more of interview perspective, because if you are getting a chance to attend Intel's interview, these are all the questions that you will get. Most of these questions are there. So please remember, whenever you are asked to write an MIPS code in the interview, you cannot write multiple instructions in the same line. You got to write only one instruction at the line, and comment should always be used with hash, and anything followed by that is the comment line. It will be ignored by the compiler or the simulator, whatever we are going to use. And remember, compiler, the comments will always terminate at the end of the line. I cannot keep writing here like this. Zigzag won't work. The moment you complete that line, the comment is getting over. You cannot bring it to the next line, and there is no new line or carriage return possible there. Remember it. This is a very important point. So what did we do? We just added contents in the four registers, but we needed three instructions. This is MIPS for you, and we can't avoid it. Let's get into the rules. There are rules which we need to follow. We must follow. There is no other option. Right. First thing, when we go for design, this is just not with MIPS. This can be for anything, any common design when you make with respect to computer architecture. You can blindly follow this, and this will be helpful. The first rule that we need to follow is keep it simple. What is it? Very simple. When you keep things simple, it offers regularity. When you keep things simple, it makes this task easier. It makes the task flawless. There will be no hindrances in between, and it's easy. So MIPS, it is all simple, they say. How do you say, sir? Very simple. Whenever we talk about C programming, we are very comfortable, because we are learning C programming from the, so almost from the 11th standard, 12th standard these days. And at least in the first year, you started using it and you are familiar with it. So if you can bring some connect to the C programming with the MIPS, that's very easy. That's the easiest way you can design something and keep it simple. Now, let's see the way it has been done. A equal to B plus C is one of the lines of code that we can write in C programming. Now, if we can replicate the same thing with MIPS instruction with a little modification, it cannot be exactly like that, because there is no difference then. We are talking about assembly language program. Hence, whenever we see this, we should be able to replicate almost equivalent, almost similar to it. If we can bring it, though not a clone, it will be easier. Now see that this is in MIPS add. So the operator is taken here and add. So what is the source? The source is B and C mentioned here. What is the destination? A. So the MIPS instruction for addition is add A comma B comma C, where the first one is called as the destination and the rest two are called as the source. The same is the case here. A goes to the left. This A is in the left. Remember, this A is in the left. Similarly, the A is in the left. B plus C are in the right. The B plus C are in the right. So what they do is they have mapped directly the C programming approach or the C++ programming approach into the MIPS way, so that people do not get confused. The people should not have to learn anything new over there, or no new perspective is added here. It's all very simple. And whatever we have learned already is what is being polished. Is it clear? Now let's take another instruction, D equal to A minus E. So what should be in the left-hand side? D. So sub D is there in the left-hand side. That's where the result is available. A minus E. So the A goes here, E goes here. So what we have done is we have exactly mapped the instructions in the C programming approach to the instructions in MIPS. This is what is called keep it simple. Let's keep it very simple, and that's how they have done it. I'm going to take a very simple example right now so that you can understand how exactly we can write it further. Now, F is equal to G plus H minus I plus J. Now, what are all the instructions that we need to use for getting it into the MIPS mode? I need to now convert this C programming line to an MIPS instruction set. I will not be able to do it in one line, but I need to do it in three or four lines as per requirement. Let's go step by step. Let's first take this G plus H. Remember, G plus H are to be added, and I do not have a variable available here. So I'm keeping it in a temporary variable called the T0. Remember it from now on, wherever we have got any temporary variables, we need to store it in the register T0 to T78. I'll tell you what is the number that we can use till then. But for now, understand that all the temporary values shall be stored in the register name starting with T. All the final results that you get can be stored in registers that will start with letter S. Remember, I am repeating it. This is very important. Whenever you have got any temporary results, that has to be stored in the register starting with the letter T. And there are numbers available. T0 to T8 is what you can use. And similarly, whenever you get the final result, sir, I have added, sir, I've got the final result. Where would I move it, sir? I would store it. I would suggest you to store it in the registers that starts with the letter S. S is meant for permanent storage. T is meant for temporary storage. And if this is altered in the paper, I won't give you mark. Very simple, because this is the notation. This is like wearing helmet when you are driving. You must do it. So don't ask me, why should I wear it? This is the way they have crafted it, and we need to follow it. So what is the first step? G plus H. The G plus H is a temporary result. So where will I put it? I'll put it in a register called T0. Don't worry, why T0, sir? I'll explain you that. We have got a lot of time and I'm going slow today. We'll take time to explain it. G plus H content is moved to T0 and this part is done. Now, what is the second part, sir? I need to go with I and J. So I added I and J. I have taken the next temporary register called as T1 and I moved the result into T1. Now, what do I have? I have got T0 with the first result, T1 with the second result. And what do we do now? We need to move the result into F. The F is the final register that they have specified. If they have not specified, you can use S0, S1, something like that for you to store the final result. Now, how do we do it? F is in the left-hand side. That's it. This one is T0. T0 is available. This one is T1. T1 is available. Now, sub F T0, T1. The same way as I told you, this is exactly mapped to this. Now, F is F here. G plus H is nothing but the T0. I plus J is nothing but T1. That's all mapped properly. And we get the result clearly as F T0 minus T1. That's it. It's very easy and simple. Now, remember the MIPS instructions that we have learned till now. We have learned two instructions. The first one is add A, B, C. Second one is subtract sub A, B, C, where A, B, C are nothing but the operands that we have used. And it has to be always 32 bit. It has to be always three operands. The entire field cannot change. It starts with the opcode, it ends with the function code. It has got three registers in between, RS, RT, and RD. You cannot change the flow. And most importantly, there is another field called SA. So totally six for the function code, six for the opcode. We have got three registers, 3 × 5, 15. So 15 plus 6 plus 6 plus there is one more field called SA shift amount, which is 5. Totally, you get around 32 bits in the entire flow. That's it. We have explained R-type instructions. I have not completed it, but I have explained it to a decent extent. Is there any doubt still now? I went very slow compared to the previous session. I want you to acknowledge me. Only then I can move faster or move better. So please go ahead and tell me if you have understood that. Have you understood it?
Yes, sir.
Was it slower than the previous session?
Yes, sir.
Can I go in the same speed? I want your acknowledgement.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, sir.
I have a doubt.
Yeah, please ask. Go ahead.
Sir, temporary registers have a range of T0 to T8 now, sir. Is there any specific range for S or it's a single register, sir?
Yeah, no. We have range. We have range for both S and T. I'll tell you that. We are yet to come into it. That's why I didn't confuse you there. So I need to talk about it a detailed way, and I'm going to do that. Probably next 10 minutes you will get to know it.
Okay.
Till now, is it all clear? Do you all understand what is MIPS? How does it look? The first design rule, keep it very simple. When you have a C program, you should be able to correlate it with MIPS. That's it. Have you all understood that? If that is the case, I can move to the next slide. Can I go ahead?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you, kids. I'll go to the next slide. Right, let's get into the next one. A bit deeper, we'll go into a little deeper content right now. But again, remember, I'll go slow. Listen to it as much as you can. If you have queries, stop it. Right? Okay. Now, the first thing that you need to understand is, though we say that the MIPS is a kind of very connected to or kind of very mapped to the C approach, it cannot be 100% done. You know why? The C or C++ has a facility of memory, luxury. We have got a lot of memory for C. We can initialize 10 variables without using in a C program. But can you do that in a microcontroller or MIPS instruction set? No, you cannot do it, because we are completely running with the registers. The registers content and the number of registers are really limited, and they are going to be the heart, kidney, liver, lungs, or whatever you call it as. So the memory related constraints are always there for embedded systems, which is no way an exception for MIPS also. Here also we have memory constraints. That's the first point. So the registers are everything. They call the registers as the bricks of computer organization. Remember, whenever you take any architecture, they are calling it as the brick. The registers are going to be the fundamental brick. And remember, another very important point, 32 bits together is getting termed as a word. I will use the term word quite often from here, which means that you need to know that the 32 bits are together called as the word. And whenever I call word, it is representing just 32 bits, right? A register is capable of storing that 32 bits. A register will be capable of storing the 32-bit content. This is what I have to tell you, and I made it clear, I believe. Let's get into the next very important inference that we have understood till now. We have got 32 registers in MIPS, and everything is 32. We have got 32 registers, and out of which, whichever register you are taking, you need to take it as only 32-bit register, and you need to even fill it up with zeros whenever you do not have sufficient content over there. So remember, everything is 32. Right. Now, we are getting into the next design rule. The first design rule was keep it simple. So we made it simple because we wanted the result simple. So we made it simple in the first thing. I want all of you to keep in mute. Please help me out. Otherwise, it is going to be very disturbing for me as well as to you. I don't want to mute you from my end. So I hope that you guys have the responsibility to mute it up with your end. Please do not make it. Can you please mute? Guys, can you please mute? Hello? Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. I have muted you, but I didn't want to do it, by the way. That's okay. At times we have to do it. I am getting into it again. 1 second. Can you see the PPT? You can see that, right? All of you? Yes. Okay. We'll get into the content. The second design rule is make it smaller. The first one is to make it simpler. The second design rule is make it smaller. What do you mean by that, sir? Very simple. If so many registers are there, what will happen? Sir, can we not have 150 registers in processor? Can we not keep it, sir? The technology is growing so much. You say that the processor is very high speed. The processor is having a lot of capacity. Why cannot we have n number of registers inside? It will be easy for us, right? We need not even come out and store things. We can all store it inside itself and it will be very fast, isn't it? No, we are actually thinking in a wrong way. We need to keep it as minimal as possible because it takes electronic signals, which is longer when they have to travel farther. What do you mean by that, sir? If I have 32 registers and if I'm accessing the 31st register, I need to go through till the 30th register and only then I can test 31st register. If I have 150 registers, the time that I need to navigate to the 150th register will be more. So what they do is they prefer that let's keep a little number of registers. For first reason, the signals navigating from start to end is going to be longer. So let's minimize it. Second reason, the moment you keep more number of registers inside, the size of the processor becomes larger. It tends to become larger. And you may not ask me a question right now that, sir, 32 is too big a number. Can we keep it as 31? No, it is not sensible. Let's keep it as 32. So 31 and 32 are no huge difference. There are questions which have come like this. That's why I'm putting this way. 32 is no great superior than 31, or 31 is no inferior than 32. So let's keep it as 32. And remember, the notations are to be followed, highly followed, without any deviations in MIPS, without which it's going to be extremely difficult. And S0, S1, S2, S3, I'll tell you the numbers in the next slide, don't worry. They are meant for storing the results in the registers, which are final. And T0, T1, T2, T3 are meant for temporary registers. And understand, this is the question that is asked by somebody. The number S0, to S7. I will zoom it here, so please have a look. S0 to S7 are the registers that you can use for the final storage of result. S0 to S7, they are mapped to the numbers 16 to 23. You can call S0 as 16 and S7 as 23. No problem, and that's absolutely right about it. You can call S0 by the name of the register or by the number that is mapped to the register. It is like I calling you with your roll number or with your name. Remember, S is for final storage, T is for temporary. S0 to S7 maps onto the registers 16 to 23, whereas T0 to T7 maps onto registers 8 to 15. 8 to 15 is for temporary, 10 to 15, so it has to start at 16. 16 to 23 is for the permanent storage. You cannot call it as permanent storage. You can store the results there. And remember, we have got a couple of more T registers as well, T8 and T9, which we will explore during the usage of the tools that we are going to use in the lab. Not now, for the theoretical purpose, let's understand we have got only T0 to T7, 8 registers, S0 to S7, another 8 registers. T0 to T7 starts with 8 to 15. S0 to S7 starts with 16 and it ends with 23. Is it clear? I hope it should be clear right now. And these are the registers that we are going to use completely in this syllabus. In this subject, we are going to use the terms S and T. And remember, whenever you are writing a register, it is mandatory to have dollar. Without dollar, if you represent a register, it is not a register. It is not acceptable. It will be wrong. So as per the syntax, as per the requirement, whenever you are representing a register, please have a dollar sign before the register name, and that is mandatory. Be it a temporary register or be it a permanent register, that's very, very important. Now, in this slide, we understood that we have got minimum number of registers only in this architecture because we avoid the need for the electronic signals taking longer time from the start to navigate till the end. Also, the number of registers, when it's getting more, the hardware gets complex in terms of the size as well as in terms of the internal construction. And when you keep 32 registers, you need not keep 31 there, which will no way improve the architecture by any bigger means. So 32 is good. Let's stay there. That's what I told you in the slide. And most important point, remember, we use two notations, S0, S1, S2 like that, and T0, T1, T2 like that. The T is always going to represent the temporary registers. The S is always going to represent the final results that you are going to store in the register after an operation. And is there not any other registers available, sir? Whatever count you are saying here, if you see that, it's going to be S0 to S7 is 8, T0 to T7 is another 8. Only 8 plus 8, 16 registers are there. What happened to the rest of the registers? Hold on, I am going to talk about it in near future, not today. Okay, so we have taken 16 registers, which are to be qualified to a decent amount, as decent extent as general purpose register. Is it clear till now? Right. We are going to go deeper, very deeper now. So please pay attention. If you have not listened even till now, now you will have to listen, because if you miss this content, you are going to be troubled. So please listen carefully. And this is very, very important for you. Please pay attention. Now, how is the R type instruction looking like? It's going to start with opcode. RS, RT, RD, SA, function code. Now the opcode for R type instruction is always 0. Remember, the opcode for R type instruction is always 0. You cannot change it. This is always 0. Sir, then how do I identify the subtraction operation or addition operation, sir? Very simple. The add operation, subtraction operation, or any other operation for that matter which comes to R type will have a function code. The function code, this field will differentiate between add or subtract or anything that we do based on the value here. The value for opcode is always 0 for R type. So what I mean is very simple. I need to put 6 zeros here. 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. This field would be always 6 zeros when you take R type operation. Remember it. This field would be filled with appropriate value. I'm yet to tell you that value, so no confusion as of now. Just leave it there. Now, remember, we will go into a very simple example. I am going to write an assembly language program, assembly language instruction with MIPS, and I will convert it to binary. I will convert it to decimal. I'm going to do that step by step, and I want you to try it out in your note once I complete the class, so that you understand each and every bit of it. Otherwise, it is going to be very tough. I could not type it. So what I did is I wrote it in a paper. I took a photograph and I presented it. So apologies, my handwriting, it's poor. Now, what is the instruction that we are taking? We are taking the instruction add T0, S1, S2. Remember, add T0, S1, S2. Dollar is to be there in all the cases. Without dollar, I won't treat it as a register. Remember it. This cannot be treated as a register if there is no dollar sign. Please understand that point and don't ignore it. Now, what are we expected to do? The question is, you need to write the equivalent decimal values for all these, the equivalent binary values for all these. That is the machine language, the final machine. How the machine interprets it. When you write add, that is for you. But how the machine interprets it? It interprets it as a machine language. The final binary has to be now presented. How do I do it, sir? Very simple. Let's first trace back to the instruction. This is an add instruction. What is add instruction belonging to? Which group does it belong to? It belongs to R type instruction. This is R type. Am I right? This is R type. So for R type, what is the format? 0 to 5 function, 6 to 10 shift amount, 11 to 15 RD, 16 to 20 RT, 21 to 25 RS, 26 to 31 opcode. This point is clear, right? I believe this point is very clear. Without this understanding, you cannot move a bit or inch above. So please understand, when you see the add instruction, you need to immediately get this remembered. I won't give you any data during the exam. All these are to be remembered. There is no option, remember it. Now, the next point is very simple. Sir, how am I going to convert this or place it exactly into this, sir? Very simple. We will go ahead and write it now here. Add T0, S1, S2. Now, what do you mean by that? T0 is where we are going to get the result. This is where we are going to get the result. S1 and S2 are the source operands, which means that they are one of the source registers. S1 is one of the source registers. S2 is one of the source registers. So this T0 is called as RD. Please understand, this T0 is called RD. This S1 is called as RS. This S1 is called as RS. This S2 is called as RT. Please understand, I completely retrieved the content from the instruction. I mapped the registers to which is RD, which is RS, which is RT. That's what I have done. Nothing else. I took the input, I mean the question. Then I mapped T0 to RD. I mapped S1 to RS. I mapped S2 to RT. Remember, this is the sequence that we followed here, and I have exactly mapped. Sir, what next, sir? That's a very good question. We need to answer that right now. Now, what is the opcode for all R-type instructions? What is the opcode? I told you sometime back, right? You guys must remember. What is it? Zero. Super. So when you keep it zero, what happens? You need to put 6 zeros here. You understand? The first, you can see that it's not first. It's the last 6 bits. They are to be 0. 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. So this part is gone. Done. Now, what is function code? The function code for add operation is 32. This I will give you in the question paper. You need not worry. I won't want you to memorize it here. This function code for add is 32. Now, how many bits are here, sir? In this 0 to 5 bits, which means 6 bits are there. So how do you represent 32 in 6 bits format? 32, 16, 8, 4, 2, 1. So if I put 1 here, that will become 32. Am I right? It's very simple. So I made 1 double 0 followed by triple zeros, which is the representation for 32. When I put 32 here, it is decimal. When I convert it to binary, it becomes 1 double 0 followed by triple 0. So this is the decimal representation and this is the binary representation. We have to write both in the paper. We have to write both in the result. I may give you a quiz, right? In that, I would have given you some different values. You need to select the appropriate one. Now, the first 6 bits are done. The last 6 bits are done. What is SA? SA is shift. Do we do any shifting in the addition operation? Do we have any shifting here? One of you? Do we really care that field? No, right? So this field is not applicable. The moment you care about it only, you need to worry about it. I don't care about it at all. So let's put 5 zeros right away. So we have filled 6 bits here, 6 bits here, and another 5 bits here. That's all finished. We have completed 50% of the task. Now, what is this field RD? What is RD? RD, you can take T0, right? T0 is called RD. Am I right? So now, when you go here, what is T0 mapped to? T0 is always represented by number 8. wherever you have T0, just close your eyes and replace it with the 8. Now, what is it here? RD. Hey, please put it on mute here. RD is 8. RD is 8. So, how do I write it? This is 5-bit field. So, 16, 8, 4, 2, 1. So, when I put 1 here, that's all. 0, 1, 0, 0 makes it RD. Now, what is RT? RT, you can see here, is S2. S2 is called RT. Now, what is the number mapping to S2? S0 is 16, S1 is 17, S2 is 18. So, I need to come here, put 18 here in the decimal value. In 16, 8, 4, 2, 1 code, if you put 1 under 16 and 1 under 2, you get 18. 1, 0, 0, 1, 0. That's all this is filled. Now, what is balance? The balance is RS. What is RS? S1. What is the number for S1? S0 is 16, S1 is 17. So I need to put 17 here and convert it to binary here. It is 5 bits field. So 1001 will get you the complete result. Now this is the final converted binary value for the instruction that I have given here. Please understand, this kind of questions will be there in the paper. This is the final converted value. So I may give this as a question. This could be your question. And I may ask you to identify what is the instruction. Or I may give you the instruction and I may want you to identify this. Either case I can do. Either way I can do. Now the only thing that you need to remember is this values. If you forget this values, you are done and dusted. Finished. You will not get the result there. You cannot work. So this is very important. And remember the flow. This has to be RS, RT and RD. You cannot make RT and RD interchange. No way possible. RS, RT and RD. Only then the final result will be correct. Otherwise, if you interchange this, this will come here and this will go here, which is not fair. All of you understood it? Any queries till now? I made it very slow. If you want me to repeat it, I'll repeat. Do you want me to repeat it? Anybody?
No.
No, sir.
All of you are clear. All of you are clear about it, right?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Right. Clear. Sir. Now, I'll give you an assignment for the day today. I want you to do it tomorrow and then show me the result on the screen. You can take a photo or mail me that. Or I believe you guys, so I don't want to cross-check if you have really worked, but let me give you an assignment. Subtract, SUB, the instruction is please make a note of it, kids, or I'll try to write it on screen. Subtract $T1, $T2, $T3. That's all. I want you to convert it to the binary, like the same way what I have done. I'll give you the function code alone because the rest all will remain the same. These values remain the same. There is no change. These fields will remain the same, no change. Shift amount is not going to work at all. This is not required. Only this is required. So in that case, you need to understand what is the value for the subtract operation. So I'll give you this also. This is in your presentation itself. So for subtract, the function code is 34. For addition, the function code is 32. That's what I have used right now. So for subtract, it is 34. For addition, it is 32. Just use this and rest all. The opcode remains the same. It is 0. Shift amount is not applicable at all. So please remember that and it's very important. I hope till now everything is clear. Are we done with it till now? No queries, right?
Yes, sir.
Is there anybody who cannot understand? I wanted to be very clear because this is the very fundamental content. And if we miss that, that's all we are done. What I did is I took the instruction. I connected it with the format of the instruction. Based on what the instruction we are having, we need to pick up the format R or I or J. And today we are talking about only R type. So we picked up the R type instruction. I connected it appropriately with each field. Then I put the decimal value for it. I converted it to binary. And that is the way the computer is looking into it. This is what I told you in the first slide. We should talk to persons. If they know only Latin, we need to talk to them only Latin. If they know only Tamil, we need to talk to them only in Tamil. So this is the language that my computer knows. So we need to also understand how your instruction will be interpreted. This is the way the instructions are going to be interpreted. That's it. This is what we try to do. And please understand, it's very important points, right? And are we in computer looking the number at the same way? Any doubts? Any doubts? Somebody started? Okay, it was a background effect, I believe. Okay, we get into the content again. Now understand this as well. Are we and the computer looking into the numbers? Yeah, what is the doubt? Yeah, please ask me. What is the doubt? Your voice is breaking. Please type the question in the chat box.
The output on this has to be zero. Then why do you even have that value?
It cannot be left out for any register. It cannot be left out for any instruction. If it can, it has to be mentioned as zero. Zero is the representation. When the processor or computer looks into it, it understands that it is R type on seeing the zero. Zero is not assigned because it is not worthless. It is assigned because we can start it with zero. You understood? So zero tells them that this is R type. That's it. It has to be there. You cannot say that why do you even have it? We must have it. When I have six zeros there, it tells that it is R type instruction. Right? It is the value that was preferred. It is not because that it is useless we put zero there. It is because we can represent it as zero and they started with it. That's it. So it is mandatory. And no instruction in MIPS can stay without 32 bits. If you cut this five fields or six fields here, if you cut this six fields, it will become a 25-bit instruction, 26-bit instruction. There is no instruction in MIPS without 32 bits. So you cannot avoid it. So what they did is they made this opcode field purposefully as zero for R-type. And they started with zero. For the next instruction, they have got some values into it. And this cannot be ignored. Remember, this is made purposefully. And it is a value which is purposefully kept here with zero. It's not ignorance. It's purposeful. Did I answer your question?
Yes, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Yeah. We'll probably stop with the next slide so that I do not want to bombard you with a lot of instructions and inputs. Once we complete the next slide, we will stop it for the today's session. Now, are we and computer looking into the content in the same way? When we look into it, we'll actually see it as base 10 numbers. We'll always look into base 10 because we are very familiar with decimal. But whatever the computer looks into is all binary. That's the reason I asked you to do this exercise. Whenever we look into it, we look into it in the format of decimal. And this is what we have done. This is all decimal values. And when the computer looks into it, it is all binary. So remember it, we need to have both the perspectives. Now tomorrow, what we are going to learn is, how are we going to use the I-type instructions, which means in the last semester, we have learned the load and the store instruction. What is load? What is store? The load is going to help me loading the content into the register. Store is going to help me in storing the content into a specified memory location. And these two belong to one particular category called as I-type instructions. Why I-type, sir? I-type means the value should be part of the instruction itself. And we make it that way. That's why this is categorized as I-type instruction. And how does the instruction look like, sir? Very simple. The first field is fixed opcode. We cannot change it 6 bits. RS and RT, I told you it's fixed 5 plus 5, 10 bits. So 16 bits are done. Only remaining 16 bits are there where we need to go with the offset. Sir, what is offset? How do we look into the offset? All these contents will be clarified to you clearly with this example, which we are going to see tomorrow. Until then, I want you to try the example that I gave you, without which it's going to be extremely difficult. And tomorrow we are going to see some very good problems, which are very nice to solve actually. So I have tried it on. There are errors in the book itself, so we tried clarifying it as well. And tomorrow we will complete the first part of design rules as well as couple of design rules in the second part as well. So with that, we complete the first fundamental section for the syllabus. And all these are very important and very easy. So it's interesting subject. So only thing that I request from all of you is please pay attention and please be focused. Once you are done with it, I think this subject is the most easy subject that you can ever learn. And that's it for today. Any questions till now? Any questions till now? Kids, any questions?
No.
Are you sure?
Hello, sir.
Yes, sir. Tell me, sir.
Sir, for this course, we have any standard books?
There is a standard book which I will circulate. I'm searching for the e-book or the latest copy. What I have is old material. The standard book is there, but it will be very confusing. If you can see that and understand something, that's great.
Sir, for working out problems, we can refer, sir.
Yeah, I will give you problems also. I've got that ready also. Don't worry.
Okay, thank you, sir.
I'll give you everything, don't worry.
Okay, sir.
That's my responsibility, and I'll give you the book. No problem about sharing the book. I am searching for the latest edition because the book is very expensive. They charge around 2,500 rupees, 3,000 rupees for the latest edition. So I've requested my friends to give me that if they have. If they are not getting it, I'll share the previous version itself so that you can go through it and you can understand.
Okay, sir. Thanks.
I have a fifth edition book, but the latest edition is somewhere around 8th, they say. So I'm trying to get it out. So I'll share this also with you so that you can learn a little bit on that.
Okay, sir. Thanks.
Right. Pavitra. And I can show you that this is the ebook that I have. This is an 848 page ebook. I have presented it right now in front of you. It's a bit complex for the first time reader. So what I suggest you to do is you can definitely read this through. I in fact recommend you to do that. But after learning the subject to a decent extent, you can go through it. Otherwise, it will be extremely difficult for you. I don't think it is a right choice at this time. So please make sure that you read it through, but after some time. Maybe once you find a little more comfort in the subject, once you get a little more familiarity in the subject, you can go ahead with it. So I am sharing the book right now with you in the chat box. Just wait. I have shared it in the chat box to all of you. You must be receiving it in the next 2 minutes so that you can download. I have sent it. I hope you can see that. It's in the chat box. So just download it and you can use it. I'll also mail you if you want, whatever way you want. Right? Thank you, kids. Stay safe. Have fun. I hope your next class is scheduled by 11 o'clock, I think. Take rest for 5-10 minutes and join the session without fail. Thank you all. See you tomorrow.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Bye-bye.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Today's session was okay, right?
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.